said today's bulletin is deja vu. It is, because that's what was on the bulletin last week, because that's what I was supposed to preach, and I didn't. And we're going to just do the same songs, only just we're going to, it won't hurt to sing them twice, will it? Back to back, week to week. It's been a busy week for a lot of folks, especially Thomas and his entire family. Thomas puts these together, and he has to put up with my changes, and usually on Sunday mornings he's wanting to know if I've changed anything before he gets here, or since the last time we talked, and, or what's gotten in my way as to why he doesn't have the information yet. So he does a good job. So this, hopefully, just singing this twice will give him a break a little bit, all right? All right. So let's stand and sing this morning. I don't have a thing there.
Steps down into darkness, open my eyes.
Is she going to be back?
She's going to be back tomorrow.
All right. Birthdays? Does anybody have a birthday that I may have missed? Because I don't have any on my calendar for today. Okay. We do have one anniversary, right? Here's a Saturday. I think you made sure we knew that ahead of time.
I tried to.
It's tomorrow, but last week I was trying to get everybody prepared.
Oh, see, I have down here the 27th, thinking it was Saturday.
Oh, no, it's the 22nd.
22nd, okay. All right, then how many years can you remember?
53.
Is that right, Sue?
52.
52, there we go.
It's been so much fun the years.
He's rushing it.
He's rushing it, right? All right. Well, I guess we'll sing happy anniversary to y'all, and then I'm going to let Renee come up. She has something she would like to talk about.
Did for us yesterday. It was a beautiful service. The prayers that you gave for us, because it was touch and go if our speaker and our soloist was going to make it with the airports. Yeah. All that mess was happening, but everybody was able to get here. We had a good time visiting and celebrating Spring's life and how she touched us in so many ways. Ladies, as usual, getting a, I'm sure, a few minutes. Wonderful spread over there in the gym, like y'all always do. And just thank you so much. These were from the Langleys and Dudleys. Feel free after church to take a spray as a remembrance, if you wish, to cut flowers. And in the back, there's still some programs from yesterday. Feel free to come, get one. And thank you again for all the prayers and love that y'all gave us yesterday.
All right. Now, I have already done a sweep of the sanctuary, Lisa. I have not seen any scorpions. Okay? Just so you know. I wanted to get some and just kind of lay them all over the floor with him. But he wouldn't let me. Yeah, that's right. One more thing before we get going. Larry, would you come up here for a minute? We have your wonderful certificate. Who's my camera person? It would be Rocky. And how do we do this? Normally it's stick that this away. There we go. Father, we come to you now pray that we made a joyful noise unto you this morning. Father, you are the way maker. Every time we think our backs are against the wall, we're between a rock and a hard place, Father God, you show us the way. Lord, you've done it over and over and over again. And we thank you that you are the light in the darkness. Father God, help us to always choose the light over the darkness. Help us, Lord, to always be mindful of what you did on that cross and what it cost that we might be reconciled unto you. Father, we thank you for these tithes and offerings and gifts this morning. Father, we pray that these would be honorable and glorifying to you and acceptable. Father, as I say nearly every week, we just so little that we actually give back from what you give us. Father, we give you praise and glory for the blessings, those who have seen things and unseen things. Father God, probably the blessings are greater on the unseen side than they are on the seen. Father, we ask now that you bless the gift and the giver of this tithes and offerings and gifts, Father God. We pray, Lord, that they would be used for uplifting and the furtherance of your kingdom, Lord. Please bless the gift and the giver, Lord, in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Many who enter through it, For the gate is small and the way is narrow that leads to life, and there are few who will find it. Father, we thank you for this brief portion of the overall message that was being said here, Lord, and we'll go further into it. Thank you, Father, that you present it so clearly that we have a choice that we have to make. And Father, choices matter. Choices have consequences, good and bad, Lord, and help us to have the wisdom and the discernment, Father, to make these choices. Lord, we just love you, and I pray that today choices will be made. Whether you act or they, whether they act or they don't act, or we act or you don't. Father, to not act is the same as making a choice. So, Father, be with us, I pray. I pray this message would go out, that lives would be changed, not only those that are sitting here this morning, but those that are out there that will see this on the internet somewhere, sometime, either today or in the future, Father God. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Choices. This particular passage here, starting in verse 13 and goes all the way to the end of chapter 7, is the end of the most famous sermon that was ever preached. This sermon was preached by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This comes from the Sermon on the Mount. It is the end of the Sermon on the Mount. And this passage is actually a call of action, a call of repentance, a call of decision given by Jesus. It's interesting that I'll be preaching a message on an altar call, as it were. Now, I want to say something up front to start this off in a good tone, in a bright tone, in a positive tone. God loves you. God loves you. God loves you. Now, we've heard the term that God loves us unconditionally. Yes, in one form of the word, he does. He cannot love us any less than he loves us. And he cannot love us any more than he loves us. But at the end of the day, he's a holy God. And if we don't accept him, that love does not cover our sins in that sense when we reject him. Now, if there's confusion there, I hope not. What I'm trying to say is God's love for you is unconditional in the sense that he can't love you anymore. He can't love you any less. But there are conditions to spend eternity with him in that love. His love will not overlook sin, is what I'm trying to say this morning. It will not overlook sin. Why? Because he's a holy God. He is unchangeable. All right? So keep that in mind. In this message, we are faced with the fact that we have all made, will make, choices in our lifetime. Amen? Those choices must be made with wisdom. For every choice that we make, there is a consequence, either good or bad. Some of us have made bad choices. I'm sure all of us have made bad choices in our lives. Some of these choices we may have regret over. And then there's other choices that have brought us great blessings too. Amen? You see, life is filled with choices and decisions. And these are often called forks in the road, right? I believe it was Yogi Berra said that if you find a fork in the road, take it. But that's not really very smart, is it? Right? I mean, we have to pick a path. We have to pick a path. And the Bible recognizes this truth. And it speaks to it on several occasions. I want to read to you a poem titled Forks in the Road by Sarah Stowell. It says, there will always be forks in the road. Decisions that have to be made. You will always have to bear the load of each debt that has to be paid. Every fork has a destination, with consequences to each choice. Be wary of earthly temptation, for it may have the loudest voice. Other paths will intersect your own. Our lives will feel its effect. Other lives will feel its effect. The aftermath may remain unknown, with results that you may not expect. Be careful not to be led astray from the righteous course you once strode. Only through faith can you find your way when you reach the forks in the road. These Bible scriptures that God's Word talks about, the first one that's really mentioned, to be honest with you, is in the Garden of Eden. They were given the choice of obedience or disobedience. We know how that turned out. But in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 19 through 20, Moses makes the following statement. I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live. Love the Lord your God, obey him, and remain faithful to him, for he is your life. So we have a choice between life and death, and we have a choice between blessing and curse. In Joshua, in chapter 24, verse 15, he's at near the end of his life, and he tells them, choose you this day whom you will serve. As for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. You have a choice. Which God are you going to choose? The God of the Bible, or the God that you've created, or the God that you want? Which one will it be? Psalm 1, which we had a sermon on, we're told to choose between the righteous and the ungodly. Proverbs 15:19 calls us to choose the way of the slacker or the way of the upright. The verse reads this way. The way of the lazy is as a hedge of thorns, but the path of the upright is a highway. So in our text this morning, we're going to look at this altar call, as it were, that Jesus is giving at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. Every person must choose either to obediently follow Jesus and his true teachings, or to disobediently follow their own path and false teaching, a choice that has eternal impact. In this passage of Scripture, these two little verses here that I read this morning, we're told that we must choose the narrow gate, or we will go through the wide way and the broad way, the wide gate and the broad way, and it says it leads to destruction. And there are many who enter through this, it says. And quite frankly, there could be possibly some of you who are still on the broad way. You haven't found the narrow way yet. Many, the vast majority of people choose the wide gate and the broad way. As we continue to look down into that scripture, if you go to verse 15 now, it says, beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them how? By their fruits. Grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor figs from thistles, are they? So every tree, every good tree, bears good fruit. And every bad tree bears bad fruit. And the Bible is clear here. Jesus is saying, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down, thrown into the fire. So then you will know them by their fruits. You see, we have to have a choice. We need to choose between good fruit and bad fruit. We We have to choose between good trees and bad trees. Because why? Because false teachers can be deceptive. But God tells us false teachers can be detected. And false teachers will be destroyed. So we must choose good fruit over the bad fruit. And then Jesus says in verse 21, and I will address this here in Luke also, Luke chapter 13, verses 23 through 30, I think. No, that's not, I believe that's right, yeah. But listen to what Jesus says. I can't think of a more scary passage of verses than this passage right here. This means that people who think God's telling us here through Christ in His sermon, that people here in this world today and even then believe that they were Christians and they weren't. That it's possible for you to say, I believe in Jesus, but not be a true follower of Christ. Listen to these verses. It ought to shake you in your boots right now. It ought to make you take self-examination. It ought to make you uncomfortable. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles. Folks, God is telling us there are people in this world, that includes preachers and pastors, who will be able to claim, they profess to claim, they believe in Christ, and prophesy in Jesus' name, and perhaps even do some of the things that would seem like miracles in the name of Jesus, and not be Christians, may not be a true believer. Why is that possible? Because Satan can deceive us as an angel of light. And we see that those of you who study the book of Revelation, you know that there's coming a time when the Antichrist is coming. And he is able to perform and do all the things like that, the miracles and talking of this way. We saw this in the great Exodus when Moses went before the Pharaoh, and he threw his staff on the ground, and it became a snake. What did the magicians and all the conjurers of the Egyptian culture do? They were able to do it just like Moses did. So just because you see signs and wonders doesn't mean that that person truly is a Christ follower. We must be able to choose between false teachers and true teachers. We must choose between a genuine confession of obedience over the false profession of the disobedient. Will you choose the difficult road and the narrow gate that leads to eternal life on the broad road, or the broad road and the wide gate that leads to destruction? Will you choose the good tree with the good fruit, or the bad tree with the bad fruit? Will you choose a genuine confession marked by obedience, or a false profession marked by disobedience? Now, when you enter as a Christian, when you find Christ and you are saved, and you enter that narrow gate, does that mean you will never, ever have to have the ability or have something come up that you must choose again the wide gate or the narrow gate? And yes, you will have those decisions to make when you're on the narrow road. Why is it? Because Satan is going to do everything he can to get you to step off that narrow path and to go the broad way. What heartache many of us, even as Christians, have experienced. Because why? Because we've stepped off the narrow path, right? Think about it in your lives. Think about somewhere in your life where You were walking that narrow path, and Satan was able to get you to go left or right from that path. And what heartache that may have caused you. It could have been, you know, there's a lot of things that we could think about in your bed, especially in the realm of sexual immorality. You might have a child out of wedlock. You might get some sort of sexual disease, or you might get some things because you're drinking a lot. You might get cirrhosis of the liver or things like that because you choose to get off the path that God has for us. He has a perfect path for us. He doesn't want us to have heartache. Yes, we will suffer because Christ suffered, but he's there with us. But we tend to do more harm to ourselves because we won't stay down that path that's been laid before us. And if you go on down in verse 24, therefore everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them may be compared to a wise man who built his house on the rocks, or the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and slammed against the house, and yet what? It did not fall. For it had been founded in the rock. Are you founded in the rock this morning? Christ is called the rock. And Christ said, upon this rock, being himself, not Peter, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. Everyone who hears the words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who builds his house on the sands. The rain fell, the floods came against the house, and it fell, and great was the fall. Folks, when we build our house, our foundation on the sand, when the storms of life come, we have a hard fall. And when we get to the end of our journey, that hard fall is hell. It's eternal damnation. It's here in this message that Jesus is preaching this morning that we come to the apex of it. We come to the climax, the defining moment of the Sermon on the Mount. The teachings of our Lord and Savior demands a response. The teachings that he's saying, he's demanding a response. This morning, sitting here idly, just listening to me as if I'm just giving you a TED talk, as it were, or by trying to remain neutral, or perhaps thinking to yourself, well, you know what? Today's not the day. I've got plenty of time to accept Jesus. That's not an option for you, really, because you're making a choice already. Sitting on the fence will not work. It will not work. If you believe that Jesus is the living Son of God and is God, then there's only two paths that we have available. There's two gates that we have that we've read about. The one that you choose has massive consequences. What are those consequences that we read about? Well, the wide gate, it says, leads to eternal destruction. Jesus, when he's preaching this, as soon as he says, as he begins this altar call, he throws a command out immediately. What's that command? He says, enter. Enter the narrow gate. It's an imperative, and it calls for a decisive and immediate action. Enter the gate, the narrow gate. This path that leads to eternal life. The reason that he delivers this in such an urgent command is quickly made plain in the very next portion of this. It says that the other gate, the wide gate, the broad road, leads to a different direction. And it leads to a different destination. It leads to destruction and to damnation. That gate is wide. That road is broad. And there are many who go through it, Jesus said. The road that leads to the gate called destruction is large, it's attractive, and it's very well traveled. Lots of people walk down it. We all have walked down it if we're and when we're honest, we've all walked down that. Some of us are on the narrow path now, but some of us are still on the broad road. This is a popular road. It's a well-known road. Ideologically, it is not narrow in its thinking. It's open-minded. Morally, it's not restrictive in its behavior. It has few rules. Virtually anything goes. Spiritually, it is inclusive. It's where we get ecumenicalism. We're all just going to sit around and sing Kumbaya. It doesn't matter what we believe, as long as we believe in a greater being. Those on the road argue that there's a wide road to heaven. You know, those of you ladies out there, I don't know if you men do, but Oprah used, this is what she used to always talk about how we're all, in our own way, we're all born, we're all praising and worshiping the same God, and we're all going to go to heaven. Whether you take the left, or you take the right, or you stay in the middle. The broad road says we're all headed to the same place. And that's what its sign says. It's a beautiful sign there. It says, you know, come this way. It's great. It's wonderful. But this broad road that we're talking about, it's not new. It's been around a long time. You can find its origin in the Garden of Eden. When Satan said to Adam and Eve, trust me rather than God. When you're on the broad road, you're trusting Satan. You're trusting you. You're not trusting God at all. And all those on the broad road, everyone will tell you, all aboard! All aboard! Come, join the party! But little do they consider that this road is a dead end of eternal destruction. I remember one time I had a conversation with an atheist, he goes, you want to live my lifestyle, John? You want to come over to my side? I said, no. I've been on your side. You want to come to mine. I've been on that road. You've been on that road. Some of you are on that road this morning. The narrow gate leads to eternal life. Jesus calls us to travel this road of less travel. He calls us to pursue this narrow gate and this difficult road. We're told up front, when you choose Christ, it's going to be difficult, this journey, because you're going to have trials and tribulations, right? We're told to pursue it. Why? Because it leads us to eternal life. And it says, few find it. You see, there's no such thing as universalism in the teachings of the Bible. Not everyone is going to be saved. Do you understand that? Not everyone is going to be saved. There are not many roads that lead to heaven. There is only one road of salvation. If you turn in your Bibles for a minute with me to Luke chapter 13, starting in verse 23. Luke 13, verse 23. I'll start at 22, just so we get it all. And he, that being Jesus, was passing through from one city and a village to another, teaching and proceeding on his way to Jerusalem. So he's heading for what would eventually be his crucifixion. And someone, it says, said to him, Lord, are there just a few who are being saved? And he said to them, strive to enter through the narrow door. For many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able. Once the head of the house gets up and shuts the door, and you begin to stand outside and knock on that door, saying, Lord, open up to us. Jesus will answer and say to you, I do not know where you are from. Then you will begin to say, we ate with you. We drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets. And he will say, I tell you, I do not know where you are from. Depart from me, all you evildoers. And in that place there will be the weeping and the gnashing of teeth. When you see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but yourself being thrown out. That would be like saying one day, when you stand before God Almighty at the great judgment throne, and you say, Lord, I'm here. He goes, I don't know where you're from. And you say, well, Lord, I was in your house every Sunday. I ate dinner with all your children. I did communion, I drank, and took sup with them and fellowship with them. And Jesus says, I never knew you. Depart from me. And where are you going? Where there's the wailing and the gnashing of teeth. Everlasting darkness. That word strive. Strive, it says, to enter through the narrow gate. That's the Greek word, I won't even try to pronounce it, but the Greek word used for strive is where we get our English word to agonize. We must agonize and wrestle. And the idea of the narrow gate is that it's so narrow that we can just barely fit through it. We're to strive, it says. We're to agonize. That's like God telling us we must, in our own fear and trembling, work out our salvation in the sense that we must agonize over what our life is. We must agonize over our sinful nature and agonize ourselves to the point where we call upon Christ and say, free me from this slavery of sin. And then we get to enter that narrow gate. When you repent, which means to change your mind, to change your actions, to turn it around, forego the things of the past, seeking only the good things of God. Jesus told them in John 14:6, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to me, to the Father, except through me. It's John 14:6. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no name, other name under the heavens given to people by which we must be saved. That name is Christ Jesus. And that's in Acts 4:12. Verse 72:5 says, for there is one God, one mediator between God and humanity, and that is the man Christ Jesus. No one else can forgive your sins. No other person who thinks there's a prophet can tell you what to do to be saved. No, only Christ can do that. Jesus is crystal clear in his teachings. The way to God is exclusive. It is restrictive, which is what drives the world crazy. The sinner who is blinded to spiritual things hates the fact that there is only one way to get to God, and that is through Christ Jesus. They can't stand it, and the devil just goads them over it. There's only one way. There's only one road, and that road follows Christ. And it is a road of difficulty, and it will involve suffering and persecution. But that road takes you to eternal life, a life that we talked about yesterday at Spring's funeral. Or services. That leads you to a land of no tears, no pain, a glorified body, completely healed, restored, renewed, standing in the presence of God Almighty, where no sun is needed. And I will say this personally, as a pastor, I can understand this statement right here. It is a road, this narrow road, it can cause us to doubt and even despair because Satan is after us 24/7, 365 to get us off the path. And when we get in a little trouble, when we get in a little persecution and a little suffering, we start saying, woe is me. And is this what you want, God? Is this what you want me to do? Am I in your will, Lord? The doubt and the despair creeps up. Because why? We've taken our eyes off of Christ. If we lose sight of how it will all turn out, we'll lose hope. Jesus wants us to understand that we can profess Christ as Lord without knowing Christ as Lord. It is possible to profess Christ as Lord and for Jesus to deem that profession of faith as false and inauthentic. So what's the test of true profession of faith? It's a transformed and obedient life that reveals true faith. Folks, if you've ever said the sinner's prayer, or you've ever come up here on a platform and you said, "Lord, I want you in my life, forgive me, please," and your life is no different today than it was when you made that profession, I seriously think you need to think about what really took place in your life there. Because a person who's had a true repentance will turn around, their lives will be transformed, because the Bible says you are a new creature in Christ. The old ways will not be good to you. You will not want to do the things of the old. You will want to follow Christ. You want to read His Word. You want to pray. And you will want to serve Him and glorify Him. You will not want to hold hands with the world as it is. It's a transformed and obedient life that we're talking about that reveals our true faith. The one who will enter the kingdom of heaven is the one who professes Jesus as Lord and does the will of my Father in heaven. Obedience is the evidence of a profession of Christ, a true profession. I wish Johnny was here. I'd make a little joke about it with him, but he's not. But Charles Spurgeon, my favorite preacher, and I was going to tell him, you can tell him, Pam, y'all can tell Johnny that it wasn't my lizard that told me this, because I named my lizard Spurgeon, by the way. But Spurgeon said this: nothing will prove us to be true Christians but a sincere doing of the Father's will. These verses, they teach us how important it is to stay close to Jesus, to know Him, to love Him, to obey Him. When you and I consider the road to walk, we must remember that Jesus is the way, and no one comes to the Father but by Him. When you and I consider the two gates that lie before us, that these two eternal destinies, we must remember what Jesus said. Jesus said, "I am the gate for the sheep." And the Lord promises, "I am the gate, and if anyone enters by me, he will be saved." Amen? When you and I consider the teachers whom we will follow, and whom we will trust to give us the words of eternal life, we must heed the words of the Apostle Peter, who said to Jesus, "Lord, to whom will we go? You have the words of eternal life." Only Jesus has those words. That's who we need to go to. That's where we get this term, sola scriptura. These are the words of God and the words of Christ. We need to go to His Word. What is it that Jesus said? Jesus said, "God has given me all authority." Then if He has given Him all authority, whatever it is you need to decide, you need to go to Christ to get the answer for it. And when it comes to the essential wedding of our confession of obedience, we should recall this scripture in particular, John 14:15. "If you love me, you will keep my commands." Folks, life is filled with choices. And may we always choose Jesus. We will never be let down. We will never be disappointed if we choose Him. So this morning, I want to ask you a few questions. Will you choose obedience or disobedience? Will you choose life or death? Will you choose blessings or curses? Will you choose the way of the righteous or the ungodly? Will you choose light or darkness? Will you choose the broad way and the wide gate, or the narrow way and the narrow gate? Will you choose repentance or rejection? Will you choose heaven or hell? Will you choose Christ or Satan? What choices will you make? Remember, your choice has eternal consequences. What will it be? this morning, everyone here, and everyone who is or will watch this sermon, you're faced with your fork in the road. You are faced with the most important decision you will ever make.